Can you advise members that apologies for absence have been received from Councillor Frank Pendergast, Sean Sullivan, Jared Woodhouse and Sue Walker? Are there any further apologies? Can you remind members that you're only required to declare, in terms of your interest at these meetings, any disclosable, pecuniary or prejudicial interest, in which case the member will need to declare the interest and leave the chamber during the consideration of that item. Are there any such declarations?
Right, can we treat one another with respect, as Malcolm said, at the beginning of every meeting. Let's get on with the business, let's treat one another with respect, let people talk. Everyone's phone off. Put your phone away. I've been approached by one councillor who needs the phone out for an emergencies. But you're here for the council and to represent this city and the people of this city, not Twitter, not Facebook. So turn your phones off and put them away. Thank you. Remember to the last meeting? Thank you very much.
So, I just noticed on the agenda, and I think it's an oversight rather than whatever. We of course lost one of our long-standing councillors, John McIntosh, recently. A long-serving, a long-standing member of the council. I think it's appropriate and fitting that we remember him in a proper and appropriate way.
Silence. Can we have the report on the election of councillors 2018, please?
Well, can I formally report the 2018 local election results are set out on pages 15 to 22 of the agenda.
Right, we've got new councillors. Can we stand up, the new councillors, please? I hate to put you up, but let's stand up and let's give them a round of applause. Welcome to hard work, hard labour. And you can please all the people all the time, but that one time you say no, that's when the downfall comes. Thank you for that. Appointment of Deputy Mayor of Liverpool, Assistant Mayor's Cabinet Members, responsibilities on Mayoral Leads. Mayor Anderson.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. I shall just say a few words around the appointments of those positions and also just to update the council in regard to my regular update with regard to the position we are with the former Chief Executive of the Council, Jed Fitzgerald. I wrote to all members of the council about the resignation letter that I received and accepted from Jed Fitzgerald. So today the existing appointments panel has moved that we start the recruitment process for a new CEO and also a new financial director. I've made it absolutely clear that the new CEO will receive no more than the current CEO. And I have also moved that the competitive financial package that the CEO will receive will not include a car allowance or car package, and that also applies to the Director of Finance. So the new Appointments and Disciplinary Panel that will be set up, of course, will include a member of the opposition, and we will circulate that to the leader of the main opposition around nominating somebody for that post. I just briefly before I move on to talk about the cabinet and the mayoral lead position, just simply say this with regards to the resignation of the former chief executive. The council, myself, have acted with integrity, honesty, and with the full knowledge of all the legal advice that we've received from people qualified in employment law. I mentioned it in my letter to all the staff and to members of the council that we've done that quite simply because we learned from the mistakes of a previous administration, which actually, if people recall, we had to pay out 1.6 million to Jason Hargrove. We all know about the downfall of Mike Storey and David Henshaw and the £450,000 package that we had to pay to David Henshaw and also to Lee Ford, to Jason Harbrow himself and to Uncle Tom Cobley and all, making a total of 1.6 million. We paid no money out to the chief executive, no payments to him have been made, other than it took us a proper due process time to go through the procedures which we followed to the letter. And we are where we are, and today, as I said, we've moved to start the process to employ a new chief executive and a new finance director. As I've done, as always, I've kept you informed of that. Moving on, Lord Mayor, in terms of how you will be also fully aware, I'm certainly, as the Mayor of Liverpool, focused and committed on what is the important thing for this city, and that's delivering on our manifesto and our priorities for the residents of this city. Just prior to the recent elections, we agreed our inclusive growth plan for the authority, which actually sets out our key aims and priorities going forward. I just wanted to make sure that everyone in this chamber can play their part in the delivery of those priorities and those better outcomes which we all want to achieve for the residents of our city. So the information which myself and cabinet members will present to members will actually reflect the local growth plan, and it will give members the opportunity to engage and scrutinise our actions and also our performance against the growth plan itself. In relation and in terms of the new chapter, together with the transformation plan and our performance framework, which we've developed together with the management team over the past 12 months, I'll advise members that you will be receiving performance indicator dashboard, which will be sent to select committees, which will cover key performance indicators, risk management and finance, so members can focus exactly on how the council is performing in each area of the council. Those that attended the seminar that I held in March will be aware that there were issues that were discussed, and I gave a commitment that we would set up a performance framework, and that's what we've been developing, and that's what it will be adopted and used for the council moving forward. I've also said that in addition to that scrutiny framework, it's my intention, as I've repeatedly said, to set up a bespoke scrutiny panel under orders and governance to consider the staging proposals that we may wish to consider when due diligence and that legal discussions are complete. And on that, I will make announcements shortly. I also intend, Lord Mayor, to set up a bespoke scrutiny panel to consider the performance in terms of the highways programme. And as you know, we're going to be spending over and above £250 million of council taxpayers' money on road repair, road renewal across our whole city. And it's important that it is scrutinised for quality and performance and value. I'll also myself personally be attending the Audit and Governance Select Committee on a regular basis in terms of providing key updates and performance information. Those updates will also include and outline any international delegations or visits taken by the Mayor, by the Mayoral team and by officers. And the outcomes and the benefits of those will be presented to the Select Committee but also to the residents of the city. I'll also attend other Select Committees depending on the issue to be discussed and debated and what's on the agenda. Of course, I'm always available to take any questions at Cabinet every fortnight and provide updates to each and every council meeting. As you recall, we are posting information at the back of the chamber, setting out key issues and facts for elected members to review and to have to hand when asked by local residents for the real fact, not what the Echo publishes. This can all be noted in the minutes and reflected in the work programmes for the select committees. You will also recall I've made great play about the interdependence of service areas within the council. But it's also critical for elected members, if they so wish, to play an active role within those discussions and debates through their select committees. I've talked to committee services about member development and also that development, member development, to have a key part of and to be a key part of the transformation plan moving forward. So in the coming weeks, you'll see how we are going to approach that with new proposals around joint training and working with officers in terms of responsibilities and engaging and empowering communities and members, and those members and those communities I want in the inclusive growth plan to play an active role in how our city moves forward. Attached, Lord Mayor, you will see the appointments for the Cabinet. Councillor Wendy Simon will be given the statutory designation of Deputy Mayor. Councillors Lily Hennigan and Gary Millett will be as locally designated Deputy Mayors, and the names of my new cabinet and the portfolios and also of the Mayoral Leads are attached, and that is my recommendations to the Council, Lord Mayor.
Thank you, my Lord Mayor. First of all, I'm sure I'm allowed to comment on some of the wider
issues. Councillor Kemp, are you going to ask a question?
Yes, I'm going to ask a question.
Thank you.
That's in the nature of a comment. So So the first question...
No, the question's a question.
The first question relates to the former Lord Mayor. Is he aware that although he is absolutely satisfied with the due process of this council, others aren't, that I've raised 13 points with the city solicitor, which I look forward to answering? Would he give this council a justification for the appointment of a new chief executive when there is clearly the opportunity here to recognise new ways of doing things, given the creation of the combined authority and the city region mayor, and we place on record that we don't think we should be appointing a chief executive in the same way? Secondly, thirdly, in congratulating the Lord Mayor on the elected mayor on having read the Liberal Democrat manifesto for the elections, is he going to put the suggestions he has made to an early meeting of this Constitutional Issues Committee? Because my colleague, Councillor Makinson, who speaks to us on that committee, has actually tabled a number of suggestions today for that first meeting. And you might find there's actually a considerable overlap between them, so it's clearly the right place to go so that we can come up with a consensus. And lastly, a question specifically on the appointment of assistant leads. You're quite right, you warned us we shouldn't believe everything we read in the Echo, but the Echo told us you were creating three leads who aren't members of the council, Frank Holton and the two others whose names I'm afraid I don't know. But there's only one mentioned here. Is that an oversight, or was it the Echo getting it wrong?
Well, my mayoral leads are in the attached paperwork for you to see and take it with no comment. With your regards to your question about a chief executive, I recall 11 months ago you pontificating in this council, arms aflame, about how we needed to sack the previous chief executive and move quickly to bringing in a new one because we had things to do and a city to run. You can't have it both ways. The fact of the matter is the combined authority has yet to appoint a chief executive. This city is the economic, cultural, and most important hub, in my opinion, in the whole of the North West. And for us to not have a chief executive moving forward would be detrimental to our city. And that's why we've acted with integrity, honesty, and with probity in everything that we've done about moving to the position that we're in. And we will now move to selecting a new chief executive that will help this administration move forward. Not what you want, or not with the politics that you want to play, but simply because that's what is the right thing to do and what this city needs.
Councillor Lathgut.
I don't want to prolong debate, but can I say on behalf of the Liberal Party group and ask, would the Mayor accept that it was a reasonable and protected the public relations damage that would have been done by a dismissal hearing by accepting the resignation of the previous CEO? And it also reduced the Council's risk of litigation on constructive dismissal by accepting the resignation. And I think we would want to put it on record, it was the right thing to do, and I found some of the comment, some on the internet sites, quite ill-informed. So if I can say that in a constructive way, I'd also ask the Mayor, can I just say absolutely clear cut, I have absolutely no qualms with the financial pressures the Council will be under and the need to pull the different strands of the council and other local authorities and other public bodies together, certainly on behalf of our group. We think having an appointment of a CEO is absolutely the right thing to do. Whatever people may feel about the past events, yeah, it is the right way to do it.
Can I just say this to Councillor Bradford? On lots of things we disagree. One of the things that at least I can say to you is that on this particular issue, with the private meetings that we've held, and I've informed you and the other leaders in the same honest and open, transparent way about what we've been doing, you've never played politics with the issue. You've accepted, with your experience, that take it more than some of the others have got, but you've always acted in the best interest of what we've done. And what I've done as mayor of this city is not given this council a bill of £1.6 million and paid off a former chief executive with £460,000. £460,000. Former chief executive David Edgar, with the debacle of the former councillor Storey, Lord Storey, Lord of Nothing, who actually gave us a millstone of a debt of £460,000, and was of course then suspended by the Standards Board, and then went on to get a lordship given to him by his friends in high office and high places. We never made that same mistake, because that's what responsible government is all about. Not playing politics, but doing the right thing. And we follow to the letter employment law and employment advice. And that's why the chief executive, former chief executive, Mr. Fitzgerald, leaves without any financial package from this city. That's, as far as I'm concerned, a good thing.
Is it a question you don't ask?
Lord Mayor, I have two questions for the Mayor. First of all, regarding the appointment of a new Chief Executive and Finance Director. We are previously on record, our budget amendment from March shows that we were looking at different ways of doing things, for example, merging posts or non-filling of posts as a way of saving money for the Council. However, if we are going to be appointing a new Chief Executive, we feel that the remuneration needs to be looked at. To most people in this city, £200,000 a year is an absolutely astronomical amount, and our recent experiences have shown that paying that sort of money doesn't actually guarantee the quality that you'd want from your staff. So we propose that we have little as a council to lose by readdressing those numbers, by reducing the amount that we're offering. And we think 20% as a minimum would be a sensible reduction. That's in line with the amendment we're putting forward relating to the members' allowance scheme as well. So would the Mayor consider reducing rather than pledging not to go over? That's my first question. And secondly, I'm glad you're moving to set up a scrutiny panel for the Bramley Moor development. I think it's high time some proper scrutiny was applied to that proposal. And could you just clarify the timeline for getting that set up, please?
The process of the chief exec has already started, so you can't stop that. That's already started. You're asking a question, so I don't want you to respond because I want to move on, because you've already responded in your answers to the previous. If you want to respond,
I haven't responded directly to Councillor Coyne's. Councillor Crone's. Question. So I'd like the opportunity to go. I'll take the last point you made first, which was, what was it? Because I can't remember.
I'm glad to hear that you're moving forward with setting up a screen.
So I did make that point clear, Lord Mayor. You're absolutely right that I will reveal soon when that scrutiny panel will take place. Moving to your first point, I often look at, you know, when we're talking about allowances, and I say things with the, you know, sometimes because I actually need to say what I see. And I see the contribution that you four make as probably the most undervalued set of contributions that ever anybody has ever made in the history of this council. The very idea that we would go to reduce the salary by 20% and then try to expect the top quality that we require for a top quality core city to actually move forward, it's just nonsense. Just absolute nonsense. If we don't expect the best, we won't get the best. If we're not competitive in what we need as a great city, not just in the UK, but globally, then we'll get second best. And the reality is that's why we will stick to that competitive offer, striking out the fact that people will not get car allowance or whatever, but we will offer a competitive package and no more than what is being offered currently. I think that's fair, and I think that's what the city would expect.
Okay, that information is made to Tom. We're going to move on to constitutional issues. Councillor Mary Rasmussen.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Can I move that the recommendations of the Constitutional Issues Committee held on the 10th of May, oh my birthday, 2018, and that's set out in the report submitted on pages 23 to 76 of the agenda, be approved in respect of responsibility for local choice functions 2018 to 19, responsibility for council functions 2018 to 2019, responsibility for executive functions 2018 to 19, scheme of delegation 2018 to 2019, delegated powers for revocation of hackney carriage and private hire driver licenses, and nomination of local authority officers to seek grants of probate letters of administration on behalf of minors. In accordance with new data protection legislation, Chris Walsh, Divisional Manager, Democratic Services and Information Manager, be appointed as the Council's Data Protection Officer.
Agreed? Thank you for that.
I was just wondering, was I totally comfortable with the outcome of the Constitutional Committee so much that I think there's two things would be helpful. I think it might be helpful for the new data protection legislation coming on the 25th if elected members get some guidance as how that will affect their casework and their communications. It leaves an hand. And I also think it would be discourteous as a council if we didn't at this stage thank Councillor Armandine for his service as Whip. Always found him incredibly constructive, incredibly helpful, and he's still a lot of the constitutional issues. And I just think it would be discourteous and extreme if we didn't record our thanks at this stage.
Thank you. Item 8, review of financial regulations. Councillor Mary Rasmussen.
Can I move that the recommendation of the Constitutional Issues Committee held on the 10th of May and set out in the report submitted on pages 77 to 91 of the agenda be approved?
Cleared, wonderful. Contract to standing orders, Councillor Mary Rasmussen again. Thank you.
Can I move that the recommendation of the Constitutional Issues Committee held on the 10th of May 2018 and as set out in the report submitted on pages 92 to 143 of the agenda be approved?
Agreed. Thank you. Agenda 10, scheme of members' allowances, Councillor Mary Rasmussen.
Can I move that the recommendation of the Independent Remuneration Panel on members' allowances as set out in the report submitted on pages 144 to 162 be approved, and that the recommendation of the Constitutional Issues Committee held on the 10th of May that the amendments to the scheme as outlined within the report submitted be approved, and the recommendations of the Independent Remuneration Panel that the allowances be increased by 2% in line with the NGC employees be approved. Just to be clear, in terms of members' allowances and how this system works in every authority, in terms of each of the amendments presented here to all the allowances referred to, have been in the past to the council and have been recommended by the independent panel set up as required within the law for this purpose, and having given careful consideration to the facts presented to them and produced full reports which were subsequently considered by the Constitutional Issues Committee and all the members of the council. Under this administration, the council has always accepted the recommendations of the independent panel, except when all members voted not to take the uplift. Can I make a suggestion? I have had a look at some of the comparisons with core cities and other local authorities, and Liverpool is the second lowest allowances paid to members, and only Newcastle is slightly lower, which by the way is half the size of Liverpool. Can I therefore suggest very kindly that the members of the council are circulated with that information so that they are speaking and moving any amendments from an informed position?
I move the amendment tabled as Amendment 1 on Appendix 3 in my name. I speak to it. My colleague.
Second.
I think. I think the point is actually made very much in your own contribution through Councillor Anderson. We are, I think, undervalued for the work of board members. I'll also say, having chaired committees, I don't think the fact that our chairmanship of committees adding 78% to the reward value of the member reflects the increasing workload. I think it's out of kilter. That's not to be critical of chairs, and it's not to be critical of board members. I have said in this chamber a number of times, I think we undervalue our board members, and many members will know how much I disagree with the contents of the Greens amendments, which I think just relegate the work councils do, but also I think actually undervalues the contribution and the ability of some people to be able to stand for council. I mean, I think every single political party in this council has had difficulty times getting councillors that are able to stand for council, and there's some very capable people who actually, when they take into account the fact the cost of doing the job, the cost on lost benefits, or the cost on tax, or impact on their personal employment, will actually deter some people from standing. So I'm not going to oppose the package put today, because I know it's being put by the independent panel. But I do think we do need a root and branch approach to look at how these allowances have been done. They were originally done on the calculation of hours, and I think it's almost 12, 14 years ago. I don't believe that necessarily would reflect the current workload of councillors. If nothing else, it needs reviewing. I'll also use two examples which are very familiar to me. We, and you will know firsthand by Lord Mayor, the amount of work that you've done as a chairman of licensing. We'll also know the amount of workload the chairman of planning has done over the years. Those are considerable workloads, but when I look at the council allowance system, I don't think that's being reflected in the council allowance system. So on item, the motion we're moving is not to deter making the actions today, but as a whole council rather than as individuals, ask the panel to look at root and branch appeal. I think that is you have made the very point yourself as a new whip. The system that is out of kilter with other local authorities, and I think the system is out of kilter with the workload for the different roles. And I think it's time we did an honest and upfront review. And therefore, I move formally the motion, which is an additive amendment. It's an additive amendment in the name of the Liberal Party group.
Thank you. Ben Anderson.
Yeah, look, Lord Mayor, I'm more than happy to accept that amendment. I think it's a good amendment to support it, but with the addition that everybody's allowances is reviewed. Everybody's, okay? So if you're acceptable to that, then I will write to the independent members panel asking them to review everybody. I'll just make this point, Lord Mayor, and correct the Chief Whip of the administration. Only in a formative way. You laugh, but it's amazing this panic. Because I'm looking at the man who's got more faces than the tap. Well, the line of building clock, we haven't got one. She said that the only time the council refused the recommendation of the allowances, the increase in allowances, was made by this council. She's wrong. I remember Councillor Kemp and all of his party opposed and actually carried through, despite the independent members panel saying that they should not pay the assistant cabinet members. The panel said there should be no remuneration for the assistant cabinet members. Their group all supported the fact that they would give them and ignored and rejected the independent panel members' allowances for their own ends. And he sits there now, that's why you have to remember these things, because as a fat man, I've got like an elephant, a good memory, and I remember those. So with the greatest respect to the chair, I remember that as if it was yesterday. Some of them are here, and they all rejected the independent members' panel's In fact, I think you supported us saying that, except that, of course, but the Lib Dems, because they were currying favour with the members and wanted to do that, that's what they did. Now, of course, it's wrong that we have Mayoral Leads and people in responsibilities. But I remember them doing it, because Alfred never forgets.
I think you in. You agree to that Joe's going to, Mayor Anderson's going to review them again with the independent. Is that okay with the Greens as well? Because it answers your questions as well. Okay, thank you for that. Councillors Kay.
Yes, I must say it's a great pleasure that the elected mayor is continuing from the previous year with his great memory, his wit, his discretion, his tact, and the way in which he tries to involve everyone in this council. It's a pleasure to actually know who the mayor is and the way he behaves. I'm actually surprised at you accepting this amendment. That's up to you. We were going to vote against this amendment for one simple reason, that in March, we were asked...
Councillor Kemp, is this on allowances? What's the question?
Yes, on allowances. Yeah.
Thank you.
In March, every single member of this council, it could have been February, but thereabout, was written to and asked to express our opinion to the independent panel. We decided not to because we were basically satisfied with the process, and we're now going to do something which we had the opportunity to do just 3 months ago. I have a particular question to ask, either to Mr. Walsh or to Councillor Rasmussen. I congratulate Councillor Rasmussen on her appointment. We too have suffered, not had welcome the appointment of a female Chief Whip, but I'm sure between the two of you, you will work with the female Lord Mayor to keep us all in order. But my question is this, in the earlier item, we accepted that there would be a variety of mayoral assistants, one of whom was not a member of the council. I'm assuming, and I can be corrected, that the scheme of allowances does not relate to a non-councillor. So that's a question. And then a question of you, my Lord Mayor, are we still moving to the amendment by the Greens? Or has that been wrapped up? I'm unclear about that, so...
I think because Mayor Anderson said there's going to be a review of all the Greens agreed to go. Is that okay? No? No, you did.
I was agreeing to accept the amendment from the Liberal Party, but I would agree not to move our motion.
In fairness, I think the motions or the amendments are really different, and I don't think he meant that. I'm only helping him out. Yeah, but can I just also personally disassociate myself from the patronising remark to women made by Councillor Cashman?
Just two things in terms of clarity. What seems to have been agreed by the council chamber from the amendment that Councillor Radford moved, that there's going to be a full review of all the allowances undertaken by the independent panel this year. So when you move to the Green amendments, the first paragraph is asking for certain positions to be reviewed by the independent panel. So that is happening from what the council have just agreed to. The only bit that remains is one sentence, and the payments of an SRA to holders of mayoral lead positions will be removed. Otherwise, that amendment has already, in essence, been agreed by the council. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And in terms of allowances, members of allowances are paid to elected members.
Councillor Brown.
Lord Mayor, given that Democratic Services have seen that our motion is now defunct, our amendment is now defunct, I'll just speak to the Liberal amendment and just point out that what we were calling for was an opportunity to look at the allowances and try to make some savings. Every single department across this city within the council has been subject to swinging cuts, and it seems only fair that some of the pain should also be experienced by cabinet council members. Now, we're not proposing a cut to the basic allowance because this enables people from all walks of life to take the decision to stand for elected office. However, we feel that the special responsibility allowances are not proportional to the additional workload the roles entail. And we're not convinced that the mayoral leads have provided value for money. So these, along with the whopping sum paid each year to the mayor, are the targets of our amendment. This, the substance of our amendment actually saves £166,000 a year, which we would like to see freed up to be spent adding staff working on the front line in children and adult services. They're the money could make a real difference to some of the people, some of the most vulnerable people living in our city. The mayor promised he'd not take the full allowance before he was first standing as mayor. He didn't follow through with this promise, and he's received the full amount available to him since becoming mayor. Perhaps support this amendment is an opportunity for him to belatedly make good on that pledge.
Councillor Brown, there's been an agreement that an independent will come in and review all right across all allowances. So that's going through. So it's going to come back to the council. So then you could actually make a representation there.
Which we did to the last opportunity to basically, the point is, most people in this room want to make a positive difference and help our community, and that's why I hope that people see things according to our memory.
Lord Mayor, that was the most blatant politics I've ever seen, and actually just really cements my view about what the Greens offer to the city. I'd make a suggestion to you that you can take your 20% reduction in your allowances and give it to me, and I'll put it in the Mayor's Hope Fund. Okay? That's a real serious offer to you. Take